By way of introduction, my name is Mike Toole. You can follow me on Twitter at Michael Toole. You can see what I'm up to at my site, michaeltoole.com, and I have a column, The Mike Toole Show, at animenewsnetwork.com. I also do some writing for the geek blog Topless Robot. You'll see a few articles a year from me on that one. So I'm curious about this subject that we're going to talk about because it's kind of a co-production deal. And I've always been fascinated by anime that has some creative elements from the West. And there's been a lot of this Marvel Comics stuff lately, and I want to kind of trace how it came into being, talk about some early versions of it, and just compare it to some other stuff and to see how it turned out and discuss it a little. So the thing is, though, Marvel Comics in Japan is really nothing new. There have been a couple of other deals over the year. Notably, Marvel struck a three-project deal with Toei in the late 70s to produce some stuff. Yeah. One of these would be the Tomb of Dracula anime, which is actually based on the comic. You got the live-action tokusatsu Spider-Man. There was a Spider-Man manga created by Ryuichi Kagami. And there was even they were going to do like a tokusatsu kind of Avengers or Captain America project. It was on the drawing board, but it was changed during production, and we got something called Battle Fever J instead. But, you know, for Spider-Man... Japan's version of Spider-Man was a little different than ours. I think my favorite thing about the spider car is that you could buy that in America. You couldn't buy the robot he flies into, but... So that's what Spider-Man looks like. So yeah, that was a thing, and that was something that Marvel collaborated with Toei. And also, there was the Tomb of Dracula anime. It's very famous, so let's just get this out of our systems now. This was actually based on the Gene Colan and Marv Wolfman Tomb of Dracula comic. That's a good one for him to freeze on. And the thing is, you look at it and think, so Dracula mugs a guy and eats a hamburger in the cartoon. That's ridiculous. What were they using for source material? Well, as it turns out, if you look at the original Marvel comics, wow, geez. Yep, that really happened. This thing, which you can watch on YouTube, was actually remarkably faithful. I think my favorite thing about it, though, is the fact that the comic was created by Marv Wolfman and Gene Colan. In the credits for the OVA, it's Mary Wolfman and Gene Colan, but not spelled G-E-N-E, spelled G-J-A-E-N, you know, a little bit feminized. So, you know, that's that. Then you have to go a little bit more recent. This is the 90s Iron Man anime. This is the Japanese theme. Look at that hair. Fabulous. So I like the fact that, you know, that this was kind of terrible American cartoon, but, you know, there was interest, and they aired it in Japan. But that wasn't actually anime, they were just using the American stuff. But they did actually create a little bit of anime for Marvel Productions in Japan in the 90s, and this is my favorite example right here.
X-Men!
These are eye catches. So much cooler looking X-Men than the cartoon. This is the second opening created just for Japan.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, that looks better than the cartoon ever did. You know, the X-Men cartoon was well-plotted and engaging, but man, if you were a 90s kid or a late 80s kid and you want your childhood memories ruined, go back and watch that cartoon. Doesn't hold up, but that sure as heck does. And the thing about that X-Men cartoon is, you know, that was created entirely in the U.S. The storyboards, the animatics were created here, and then all the in-between animation was shipped off to the Far East. There was some that was animated in South Korea, and Toei did some subcontract work on this, but you know, it never really looked as good at that. And it wasn't a true collaboration. That would come a little bit later. The big thing we're gonna talk about is Madhouse launched a collaboration with Marvel a few years ago. And this was actually in the wake of the original Iron Man film. They had been in talks to do it for several years, but the success of that Iron Man film is what really pushed it forward. And Madhouse, of course, are the guys that made Ninja Scroll, you know, the great Trigun, Millennium Actress, you know, wonderfully critically acclaimed stuff, and of course the realest anime ever, Cardcaptor Sakura. You can imagine that when he got the chance to, you know, collaborate with a top studio like Madhouse, Stan Lee himself only had one course of action. He had to pick up the phone.
Konnichiwa. Stan Lee Jason.
Had to call, you know, pick the phone up and call them up. But
Stan Lee? None.
As a result of that, a couple of trailers were released a couple of years ago by famous anime directors, and we're going to watch these trailers because they rule. This first one is directed by a guy named Takashi Koike. And you just look at that and you think, man, that shows so much promise. So yeah, that was directed by this guy, Takashi Koike. And if you're a real deal animation fan, you know him as the director of Redline, which is a great film. But yeah, he's one of Madhouse's top talents. He's been an animation director and an episode director and a features director for years. So the idea of someone like him adapting Iron Man was very exciting. And that wasn't the only one. There was also a trailer for Wolverine.
Thank you.
Yeah, pretty cool, huh? He's kind of got the hockey hair. But yeah, Logan looks awfully pretty in that. It's very nice. And that trailer was directed by this guy, Rintaro, who's one of anime's, you know, grand old masters. He's in his 70s, but he's still working his butt off. And if you've, you might know him as a director of stuff like Metropolis. So again, the idea of someone like him working on anime is a cool thing. But what we ended up getting when the TV shows started coming out was a little bit different. Now I'm curious because I've talked about this at panels before, and I'm wondering how many of you are familiar with this Marvel anime or have seen some? Yeah, so about half the room, and that intrigues me because this was pretty high profile. This was aired on TV. It was on G4 a couple of years ago. It was released on DVD, and yet it's this kind of thing that even though the Marvel movies are incredibly popular, these just aren't as well known. Before we start looking at a couple of clips of them, and I also want to point out that these aren't really East-West collaborations in a true sense. The way these were created is that the comic writer Warren Ellis submitted a story treatment, a 5 or 10 page story treatment for each one of these that kind of loosely linked them all together in their own little continuity. That treatment was translated and handed over to Madhouse, who gave it to their script writers, who wrote the episodes. And then the episodes were created by the animation team. But let's look at what the Iron Man TV anime actually looks like and think about how that trailer looked and how it compares to how this looks.
Well, my old friend, it looks like you and me have one last rodeo.
So pretty cool, right?
Whoopsie. Hope I didn't go overboard. Hey, buddy.
Impact imminent.
So we got Iron Man, you know, fighting knockoffs, Dio armor created. The thing I like about this show is that it reads, the plot of it reads like fan fiction. It's Tony Stark gets to go to Japan and he meets a cool, you know, reporter lady and gets a scientist girlfriend. But the thing is, if you compare what we're seeing there to what we saw in the trailer, it's a little different, right? The trailer was always gonna look better, but the whole approach is a little different. That's because it's not directed by Takeshi Koike. The guy who directed this version is a guy named Yuzo Sato, who, in fairness, is a very experienced animator at Madhouse. If you've seen the shows Kaiji or Akagi, you know, the kind of gambling desperation stories, he directed those. But those are his highest profile projects by far. He's normally a key animator or an animation director kind of guy. He's not really a story guy. And this would kind of set the tone for what comes after that. And you know, I could never really get used to the character designs either. It's like, to me, Tony Stark there, he just looks too evil. Even when he looks kind of shocked and silly, but you know, I guess it's still an improvement over the earlier cartoon. Dang. And then, there's the Wolverine anime. This was directed by a guy named Hiroshi Aoyama. Let's look at a clip of that and see how that compares to the trailer. And I'm showing you these in the order that they were aired in both Japan and the United States. They started in, I think, in the winter of 2010 in Japan and in the summer of 2010 in America. They hit Japan a little bit earlier, but not that much earlier. Let's look at Wolverine.
Everybody know we were there.
I'm guessing the surprise party was arranged by the same person who murdered your friend.
Well, well, Wolverine. And from the looks of things in peak fighting form,
so yeah, and story-wise, this is a spin on the original Wolverine Frank Miller limited series where he goes to Japan and gets tangled up in all kinds of that business. A couple of interesting things about this is that you may have noticed that what hits me about this sequence, and you see it throughout the series, is that Wolverine goes into action and he gets to cut dudes up, which is great. But his sequence, there's a flash and then like a freeze frame or, you know, a drop-off frame of, you know, people getting sheared apart. The girl, on the other hand, she's much better animated. And in this case, the reason for that is that her sequence there was storyboarded and the animatic was created by a guy named Yoshiaki Kawajiri. Anyone ever heard that name? Yeah, he's a guy who directed Ninja Scroll, he directed Demon City Shinjuku. He's another one of those great old veteran animators. He's about 67 or 68 now, so he's slowing down. He did not direct this, he just did the animation direction. The guy who did direct this, Hiroshi Aoyama, his most high profile thing ever is a show called Rocket Girls. Anyone ever heard of it? It's not terrible, it's based on science fiction novels. It's about teenage girls going into space to work on rockets. It's actually somewhat realistic. But yeah, that's, you know, they went from the trailer directed by Rin Taro, who directed Metropolis and Harmageddon and Dagger of Kamui and a whole string of incredibly influential and high profile films, to the guy who made Rocket Girls. So we can see a theme coming into place here where to sell the project, to get it off the ground, Madhouse put their top talent on it. But once things were underway, they put their second stringers in. And that kind of affects the quality. Like the Iron Man anime, I would say that about maybe four or five of those episodes are pretty good. The rest, not so much. You know, of course, for some shows, that's a really good ratio, but not so much this time. One thing I do kind of dig is that the voice of Iron Man in the TV anime is Adrian Pasdar, who's one of the actors from Heroes. And he's also the voice of Tony Stark in the Avengers Assemble cartoon. So that's kind of some cool crossover. Another Heroes dude, Milo Ventimiglia, is the voice of Wolverine here. I think that was kind of a mistake because there's already, you know, an obvious voice of Wolverine. But, you know, again, The aesthetic is pretty cool. It still looks good, and it's definitely an improvement over the original. Although I dig that yellow costume, you can't argue with that. Then Wolverine led straight into X-Men, which, you know, this again reads like fanfic, although they do use a character from the comics where it's like, oh, there's a new member of the X-Men and she's a Japanese girl. This was directed by a guy named Fuminori Kizaki, and I would say that out of all of these directors, you'll notice, I think his style is the most American animation-esque. He directed an episode of Afro Samurai, and if you got Super Street Fighter 4 when it came out, it was packaged with an animation. He directed that. So that's his work that you might have seen here. Let's watch a clip.
You need a reason to fight, and I've lost mine.
Scott, snap out of it. Who said anything about fighting? We're just going to look for a missing teenage girl.
If Emo Boy wants to spend his life crying about something that happened...
Here's the real Wolverine voice.
Logan!
Oh, come on. Listen to him, will ya? Full of self-pity. He'd be useless to us anyway. He acts like he owns her. Like she meant nothing to the rest of us. Well, there's one thing I know for sure, bub. Jeannie'd die all over again if she saw the way you're acting.
Stop this!
Hey, psych, what'd I do? Hit a nerve? You know, that might have stung a little bit more if it weren't for my healing factor.
You want to feel real pain? Say her name again.
Jean.
Why do you have to be such a guy and pretend that you don't care? Is it that hard to admit that you've been as worried about him as the rest of us? Please, we have to find her. She's out there somewhere, all alone. If we don't find this girl, nobody will. There are still people that need you, Scott. The X-Men need you. You know it's what Jean would have wanted. Well, you know where we'll be.
That sequence was one of the most, you know, actual action-packed sequences I could find in the series. So problems are developing. There's a lot of still frames, a lot of jiggle, a lot of standing around. One thing that is good about this series is that they actually let Cyclops do stuff. I always felt like he was underused in those Hollywood films. I also dig the way Storm is very obviously modeled after Halle Berry. It's kind of cool. And of course, the voice of Wolverine there is Steve Bloom, who is the correct voice of Wolverine. At least, you know, for modern times, you know, if you're gonna get Wolverine, you use this guy, you don't recast him. You know, that's the aesthetic of the show, and you know, I screwed up in my notes. There's the Japanese X-Men character, and I can't even remember her nickname. One of you knows, right?
Armor,
that's right, yeah. She can grow her own armor. But the aesthetic of this is still pretty cool, and it's one of those, yeah, it's not awful, it's just not that great. It feels like it could have been better. But again, at least it's a little more modern looking than this. Yeah, I was going to say, I did this to make you guys laugh. This is the X-Men from when they appeared in Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends. It's one of the best cartoons ever, but, you know, it's a cartoon. And then the final TV Marvel anime project was Blade. And I'm really happy they did Blade, because Blade doesn't get its due, I think, in terms of Marvel media being developed. There were popular superhero movies in the 90s. The whole boom was started by Batman in 1989. But the whole thing was in a lull, kind of in retreat through much of the 90s. And when Blade came out, yeah, that was a big success, and that made Hollywood believe that superhero movies could work again. And a lot of people will point to, like, oh, well, you know, the Marvel movie resurgence, that was X-Men, that was Spider-Man. No, it started with Blade, I think. And this was directed by a guy named Mitsuyuki Masahara. And again, we see a theme where the biggest thing that he had done prior to Blade was he directed some episodes of a show called Cheese Sweet Home, which is a whimsical little story about the adventures of a kitten. So you have a director who goes from kitten to Blade. Let's watch a clip.
It's a myth. The vampires want you to learn.
but I found that a silver blade to the heart works just fine.
You! Your blade!
Go on, get out of here. Unless you want to die. You.
What?
That nightclub's your feeding ground, isn't it? That glyph on the wall over there. What's it mean?
Like I would know.
Answer me.
Right. The glyph's the symbol of our organization. It stands for existence.
Organization of vampires.
You'd be surprised. We're all over Asia and growing.
Do you know where I can find a vampire with four fangs?
Huh? No, never heard of him. It's the truth, I swear! That's right. Sorry, ass. You better run before the boss gets here.
Your boss is coming here tonight. Good. Can't wait to meet him.
I just liked that scene because he lets the vampire security guard think that he got off the hook. And no, totally didn't get off the hook at all. So yeah, this was the final TV Marvel anime, and they're all kind of very loosely linked together. Like Wolverine appears in multiple ones. He shows up in Iron Man briefly, and this is another one that's kind of like, oh, it's a story where Blade is looking for vampires in East Asia. So there's kind of that connection going on. It's kind of a cool thing, but again, it feels like it's starved for action, and that's kind of surprising to me. And all these shows were aired on G4 exactly once, and they were released on DVD. And the reason why I'm fixated on these shows, and I think they're important, and I'm a little disappointed in how they turned out, is because this is some of the only anime that when they came out, you could go to like Target and Walmart and find them there. And the discs, which you can still find, you know, the shows aren't terrible. They're bilingual. You can get the whole things, you know, for about $8 or $10 each. You know, it's something that I think is pretty cool. And again, I like the aesthetic upgrade. And I think the fact that it's not even the Wesley Snipes Blade so much. You know, he looks more like the Sticky Fingers Blade from the TV series. But it's a good look, and it's definitely better than how Blade looked in the '90s Spider-Man cartoon, where he used. I don't think he used any actual edged weapons. He had like a laser sword. And so you think, okay, that was the Marvel anime project. And when this was in development and the first show was rolling out, every year I would go to Otakon and talk to the general producer at Madhouse, a guy named Masao Maruyama. And it was one of those, you could kind of tell that his enthusiasm was flagging a little as it went on, because he was happy to answer questions about it. It was a productive relationship for Madhouse and Marvel, but it was one of those things that as the years went on, he just kind of wanted to talk about it less. He would eventually found his own studio called MAPPA, and a few other ex-Madhouse staffers I've talked to as well, they're not excited about Marvel anime, and that's kind of too bad. I'll touch on that again later. Fortunately, though, it wasn't all over for Marvel anime, because then we had this. Yeah, this is actually based directly on some of the comics material. There are characters and situations that are adapted for this. But yeah, it's an Iron Man anime with some cool guest stars. You see this Hawkeye, this Black Widow, and down at the bottom there's the Punisher. We're gonna talk about him in a second. But let's watch a clip of how this looks.
Look out!
You're not too good at this, are you?
Widow, he's getting away!
No shit!
Tell me something. Are you trying to be as obvious as you can?
What's the matter, hero? I thought you liked the attention.
Not when I look like 5 miles of that road.
Well, then you better hang on.
What are you, crazy? It's over! when Captain Crazy Go Nuts is gonna take you seriously as a hero, know what I mean?
Arrows, really?
Don't do it, Frank. You're just following orders.
Don't worry, I'm not trying to kill them. They don't need their kneecaps to breathe.
So you better come out.
Oh, we hear you. But before we do, here's a little gift.
No!
Bastard.
Drop the piece. It's that easy to get the drop on the Punisher? It's not. So you can see that immediately, this looks a lot better than the other shows. And part of that's because it's an OVA, it's a shorter production, direct-to-video. I dig the way that they got blonde Hawkeye going on because, you know, in the movies, he's Jeremy Renner, who is not blonde, but in the comics, Hawkeye is a blonde dude. So they kind of got that going on. I think the most fun thing about this, though, is this guy, the Punisher. And you think, well, that's not really what Frank Castle looks like that much, is it? You know, he's kind of got this pretty boy thing going. But it's still, it's kind of an upgrade from Hollywood in the 90s. And for when I first started seeing screenshots before this came out, me and all my friends just referred to him as Moe Punisher. You know, the cute Punisher. And I really think that the best way to describe him is I did a talk at the science fiction con Aresia covering these shows with a panel of experts. And someone in the audience who was not that familiar with anime but loved the comics took one look at this guy and was like, he looks like a J-pop singer. So I hereby dub him Smap Punisher. But let's talk about why this turned out better than the other productions. And to me, it's pretty obvious. But yeah, I'm sorry. Before we do that, we're going to look at one more clip. And this is probably my favorite action scene in it. And I'm happy to say that this just came out on Netflix streaming, so you can go home after this and watch it.
Confirming his target, Anthony Edward Stark. Checking profile. Target identified. Mr. Stark, please throw away your weapons and surrender immediately. There is no way for you to escape. Give up your weapons immediately and be taken into custody. Do not make any aggressive moves. We are authorized to use deadly force. Repeat, we are authorized to use deadly force. This is your final warning. Surrender immediately. Repeat, surrender immediately.
Sorry, Nick. I don't have time to waste right now. I'll pay for the damages. I still have things to do.
Fire!
So pretty cool, right? What I like about that is that you can see right away that they're trying a lot harder to recreate the aesthetic of the trailer. Iron Man isn't just kind of unshaded CG. You know, there's depth to the way he looks. And, you know, the S.H.I.E.L.D. mecha, the design is better. It looks a little bit more practical and interesting. And the action is just really good. And the best part is, you know, those two clips I showed you, you haven't even seen the bad guy yet. So there's at least, you know, five or six more really good action scenes. And again, it's on Netflix. You can watch it. And one other bit of trivia, you know, the guy who played Tony Stark in this version is a dude named Matthew Mercer. He's here. So, you know, if he sneaks in another autograph session or he's at the round table, you can go and ask him about what working on this was like. But the thing is, all this other stuff, directed by, you know, Madhouse animation directors, key animators. In other words, you know, they're the A-team when it comes to creating animation, but the B-team when it comes to steering a production. But this film was directed by a guy named Hiroshi Hamasaki. He has a lot of experience as a director, and in fact, he directed this. Anyone recognize it? It's called Steins Gate. It's, I think, one of the best TV anime of the past few years. It's some darn good stuff. And his title, Kantoku, the director, one of the guys working under him, the unit director or episode director, is a guy named Shingo Natsume. Does anyone recognize that name? Shingo Natsume is the director of Space Jam. Yeah. You think of Shinichiro Watanabe. Watanabe is the sole Kantoku, the general director. Shingo Natsume is the Kantoku, the guy who works directly under Watanabe. In this one, he's the Enshutsu, the technical director. But yeah, right away you see, okay, these are two of the top names in the business. So when they get these guys working on it, suddenly the results are much, much better. So this is one of those, yeah, I actually really recommend this one. You can watch it on Netflix, and unfortunately, I don't think it did that well on DVD because it's already in the $5 bin at Best Buy. But absolutely worth seeing. And fortunately, you know, you have to ask what's next. Marvel Anime with Madhouse isn't quite done yet. There's more stuff coming. Let's watch a clip. This is Punisher and Black Widow.
Castle? Castle, what's wrong?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty good because at least the Punisher gets to murder a lot of people. This thing comes out this week on DVD. I think it comes out on Tuesday. If you want to watch it right away, you can get it on Amazon for like 10 bucks. I watched it. The action sequences are pretty good, but story-wise, it's not that great. It's actually very loosely based on a graphic novel that came out at the end of the 80s where the Punisher and Black Widow team up to fight bad guys. But, you know, when they updated it, it's like, okay, she's fighting evil Punisher who was hypnotized by a cell phone. And there's, you know, there's the plucky kid character. But there are a couple of things that are really telling about this production. The first one is that the Technovore OVA came out in April of this year in the US. It came out in Japan 2 weeks later with the Japanese dub. This thing comes out this week in the US, and there's no Japanese release scheduled at all, even though this is Madhouse. So that's kind of weird. And another thing about this is, well, first of all, yeah, we can talk about the director, Kenichi Shimizu. He's never been like the Kantoku, like the top line director on a project before. This is his first, so he's a rookie director. His most high profile project as an animator, probably this stuff. He worked on all the Fatal Fury anime, so he's good at doing action scenes, but he's not that much of a director. And another really telling thing about this film is that, let's compare the box covers, you know, the key artwork. Technovore, it's like, okay, this is obviously Marvel anime. And if you look at this other one, Avengers Confidential, Black Widow and Punisher, it's interesting. You'll let me look at that, man. It's like they kind of tried to de-anime it, like they're trying to move away from that, which is pretty weird, right? I mean, just look closely. That's what the Punisher looks like on the cover of the film. That's what he actually looks like in the film itself. So there's a truth in advertising issue there going on, I think. The other funny thing is you see like the Hulk and Iron Man and Thor on there. That's cute, but they're really they're pushing it. Those guys don't appear in this film for very long at all. So yeah, I mean, so plunging forward, oops. And last but not least, there's still an aesthetic upgrade, I think. This is the quick shot that Hawkeye appears in the film. Looks a little bit different from the other versions, and yeah, he's cloaked in darkness there. But I still think he looks cooler than he did in the 90s cartoon. And another telling thing about these projects that I want to point out, which I think is interesting and just kind of weird, is that there are extras on these DVDs where key creative staff talk about the project. The thing is, though, you start that up and the key creative staff are these dudes. Which is like, okay, that's Joe Quesada, who's you know, the general director of Marvel. That's, you know, the lady on the lower right, she's in charge of Marvel's TV productions. So she's in charge of the Avengers cartoon and, like, you know, the Spider-Man cartoons. That's kind of her department. But I think it's interesting and kind of strange that they talk a little bit about sending stuff off to Japan, but in the Marvel anime, there's never really any interviews with the people who actually made it. Which just makes me think, yeah, it's kind of strange that they're taking that approach. And too bad, because as we can see, the one production where Madhouse threw their best people at it, they got results. And but that's what Marvel anime has kind of turned out so far. There may be something in the future from Madhouse, but there's nothing on the slate right now. Fortunately, there is more Marvel anime coming in the form of this. Has anyone heard of this? Yeah, a few of you. This is Marvel Disc Wars, The Avengers. This is basically gonna be a Marvel version of Pokemon. Or Beyblade, or something like that. It's all about the Avengers as little transformable toys that children can use to fight their battles. Let's look at the promotional trailer. This is coming out in Japan very soon. I think in 2 weeks. Yeah, so, okay, this it's not the kind of stuff for older fans that we were seeing earlier. This is going to be for children, but I don't know, I'm kind of intrigued. I want to see them team up with Spider-Man and the Wasp. But yeah, it's basically going to be Avengers Pokemon. I do think it's kind of weird and a little disappointing that this comes out in Japan, April 2nd. And there's nothing has been announced for the U.S., North America yet. And it's just like, well, it's coming out this summer, right? There's going to be more Avengers movies. But hopefully we'll be seeing that soon. And the interesting thing about this is that all the stuff that we saw before from the recent past was Madhouse. This is Toei. So they're going back to that old partnership they had at the end of the 70s, which is kind of cool. So that's about where we are for Marvel anime. So I'll wrap it up with a few thoughts and then maybe we can talk a little bit about it. I talk on Twitter with a former Madhouse guy, a production manager named Yoshihiro Watanabe. And he's talked about Marvel anime a little, and it's one of those, this was one of those things that was a grand idea. And if you ask him about specifics, he's like, well, it wouldn't be right for me to criticize a studio I don't work at anymore, but I have questions about the way they did things. The thing is, about a week and a half ago, I posed a question to Mr. Watanabe, and I said, what do you think the most successful Marvel anime was from a creative and production standpoint? And his answer surprised me, partly because it was kind of a trick answer. His answer was this, which I don't know if you've seen this one, but this isn't really anime. All of the key creative stuff, the scripts, the storyboards, the character designs, and some of the key animation was done in the US. But the way this was handled was that the key creative stuff was done in the US. The unit, the unit animation was done in Japan, and the line animation, the in-between animation, was done in South Korea. And, according to Mr. Watanabe, this arrangement just suited everyone. It worked really well, and it created good results. And this is another one that you can watch on Netflix. And yeah, it's really good. And it's one of those, the Japanese staff were very satisfied with the work they did on this. And yeah, you ask the people who worked on Marvel anime what their favorite Marvel anime was, and it's not even really Marvel anime. It's kind of telling. And I'm going to break from Marvel just for a second and point out why I find these co-productions so interesting. It's because the whole world is working together. This next sequence was created entirely by an animator named Hironori Tanaka using two or three storyboards supplied by an American artist. This is a Justice League.
I still can't believe what you tried to do.
You hurt me, Jordan. You broke my heart, and I'll never stop trying to hurt you back.
So yeah, I mean, it's interesting to me that really the best results a lot of the time comes from one piece of the pie being handled by the Americans, the actual line animation being handled by the Japanese. I mean, I don't know about you guys, I thought that one sequence looked better than anything from that Green Lantern movie. And it's a pretty good OVA. So, I mean, I'm hoping that we see more collaborations like this, like I said, because although, this is the kind of stuff that can make new anime fans, because this was sold, stuff like this gets sold at Walmart and Target, and it's gonna be put in front of people who don't know a lot about anime. So, I see that as a desirable result, especially because these movies make so much money at the box office. But we can just hope and pray that it all kind of goes the way we want it to. So I have about 10 minutes left, or about 9 minutes left, which is rare. Usually I don't do a lot of Q&A or discussion. But has anyone seen these? Does anyone have any thoughts on these? Yeah, you, sir.
I have a quick thought.
Yeah.
The problem that you have is that, come here.
Yeah. 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 And that's a good thought, and I think that's interesting in light of the fact that the Avengers Confidential one that just come out, it's like marketing it, they're backing away from the anime aesthetic. Yeah, yeah, and it's kind of weird that the comic book crowd maybe necessarily doesn't want this. The thing is, I don't want the comic book crowd, man. I want the people who go to the movies to see this stuff. Because a lot more people are going to see the movies. Anyone else yet? Yeah. It's okay. Yeah. Hulk versus, yeah.
I saw half of that.
Yeah.
Because I had heard about Deadpool's inclusion.
Yeah, Deadpool's in that, yeah.
So I watched that, and I can't tell you the premise, but I still remember, hey, Logan, I killed you. I was
think Deadpool has shown up since then. And yeah, that's another missed opportunity, because imagine a Deadpool anime. Let's hold hands and imagine that, because come on, it's very likely they'd screw it up, but they'd probably screw it up really wonderfully. You know? Yeah. Yeah. I'd watch it. Yeah, it really sums it up. I will say that in Avengers Confidential, my favorite cameo is that the updated version of Ms. Marvel shows up really briefly. You know, she's got the newer costume and the spiked up long hair. She doesn't have any dialogue, though. It's one of those things, just like, it's so cool to see that character, and then it's like, but if you're not really familiar with Marvel, you don't even know who she is. It's that kind of thing. And, yes, sir?
I actually had a question on a kind of related note.
Yeah. Almost every one of those has some production in Japan. Like I said, that piece by Hironori Tanaka, the Justice League movies. Basically, it's a similar arrangement to what was happening with the Marvel stuff, where all of the primary work is being done in the U.S., but some of the most important sequences are farmed out to Japan. Japan does the best touch, and the finishing touches and in-betweening stuff is done in Korea. Yeah. That stuff.
Yeah.
One thing that you can do is you go to YouTube and you type in like Justice League Sakuga. Sakuga is the Japanese word, S-A-K-U-G-A. That's the Japanese word for drawing. And that's the word that animation nerds use to share animation. And that's where like you can find some of the best sequences. They will actually identify which artists created which sequences, which is how I found out that Mr. Tanaka did that sequence. And yeah, that guy's like an action animator who's done all kinds of cool stuff. And I like the fact that, yeah, that's him. And I will say that about 5 or 6 episodes of the 90s Superman cartoon, you know, the Superman animated series, which is pretty darn good, those were directed by a guy named Yuichiro Yano, which is interesting because they were basically, because of deadlines and other factors, we're taking the scripts and the storyboards and just sending them to Japan. Those episodes were created pretty much entirely by Sunrise. So hey man, yeah, the Superman, it's totally anime. Yes? Well, I think it's gonna hinge on what's gonna happen with Discourse. I think if they can get that on the airwaves and more importantly, get those toys in stores, because kids love Marvel stuff, that's going to keep that fire burning. Because we're going to get Marvel movies in perpetuity, because those are such good moneymakers. And I don't think the Madhouse stuff has been unsuccessful. I think, you know, financially, I think those have been doing okay, but it's just creatively, they haven't been that rewarding, which is a little disappointing. But as long as those things can get out there and get to the people, we're going to keep seeing them. And that's part of why I wanted to talk about this, because this is a thing, and we're going to see more of it. So yeah, I would say there's definitely going to be more. Yeah. An Indian cartoon? Well, I mean, there's a Turkish movie where Spider-Man is the bad guy. Yeah. I mean, there's stuff like, but that's unauthorized. The thing about that toy Spider-Man from the beginning, that's an authorized production. Marvel.com actually had those episodes streaming for years. They took them down, which is awful of them, but you can still find a lot of them on YouTube. They're still out there. Yeah, Spider-Man. My favorite detail of that Spider-Man show with the big robot, they lost that robot. That costume was stolen after about 3 or 4 episodes. They had to finish the series using stock footage. So for the entire rest of the series, it's all cut to the monster, cut to the robot, then cut to you never see them in the scene together because they didn't have the suit anymore. Awesome detail. But yeah, that's an ultimate East-West collaboration. It's one of my favorites. It's a lot of fun to watch. I mean, come on. You know Spider-Man, he gets his powers from Planet Spider. That's exactly how it works. Okay, I think we're just about done. Any final thoughts? Yes? Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think that the creatives that we saw, like Quesada and the director of television, they probably rubber stamped that stuff. But no, the intriguing thing about the Madhouse stuff is that that wasn't done with a lot of oversight. That was, you know, they got the story outlines from Warren Ellis, but they were free to create from there. And the Techno War one was freely adapted from a couple of comic stories. It doesn't really resemble the comics that much, but. You know, I think they have relatively free reign, which is why I find those ones so intriguing, because it's familiar characters through a very different lens. Yes? Yep. Oh yeah, always stay through the credits. Even Technovor and Avengers Confidential, nope, they have the post-credits cookie scene where there's something else going on. But we're at 1 o'clock, so thank you guys for coming. Now go away.
Well, a song about never saying never and never being told what you can or cannot do. This is One of Us. Or when fighting got to me, I looked to find examples on the field of chivalry, and I saw mighty arms, much stronger than my arms could ever be. So I thought perhaps that field was not for me. But still I stayed and watched the fighting till one figure stood apart, in armor newly fashioned and a helm more pot than art. But each blow was thrown with honor and the lightness of the heart. So I took that step which soon became a start. Cause she was not the biggest fighter, nor one to raise a fuss, but I remember being proud that she was one of us. And we might never stand together in a shield wall side by side. Because of her I lift my sword with pride. Was ladylike and lively, not the type you would expect, with a braver heart than many and a slot shot to respect. And I guess she'd once decided this was where she'd like to be, and I thought if she could do it, why not?